Susan. And hello, everyone. Very excited to be with you. First, please join me in thanking Susan Patrick and her team for all the hard work that goes into putting on a large conference like this, and in particular, for using their spotlight to focus on personalized learning. So thank you very much for that. So of all the experts in the room here, we are very fortunate to have two titans from the field here in Alex Hernandez and Dr. John Covington with the EAA.
By the way, I just busted Russ tweeting on stage, so if you can verify, just let me know.
So, I mean, they really need no further introduction. Susan, thank you for that. So we're going to jump right in. Incidentally, as Susan mentioned, we are using Twitter to collect your audience questions for our Q&A segment. So please send those in, hashtag iNACOL13, and we'll get to as many of those as we can. John, we'll start with you. Given that this room is filled with many folks, but perhaps with different perspectives when it comes to the conversation on personalized learning, let's level set a little bit. Define what personalized learning is and what you're currently doing in the field.
Sure. First of all, I think in the Education Achievement Authority of Michigan, we view personalized learning is a system where basically time is the variable, learning the constant, and students the focus. A system that allows students to start where they are and move through instructional levels at their own pace. We think it's vitally important. When you look at the progress or lack thereof that our students managed to have when we took those schools at the beginning of the authority, it was the performance was absolutely positively dismal. Some of the things that we've done thus far to advance the implementation of student-centered learning in the EAA is we've lengthened the school year. We've gone from 175 days to 210 days per year for students. We've added 45 days to the school calendar, 8 hours a day for teachers. That was a big change that everyone had to adjust to. We've done a number of other things that really foster the implementation of the student-centered approach to ensure that students are mastering those content skills that they need to complete their secondary school experience, college and career ready.
And how has student achievement been so far?
Well, at the end of our first year, we ended the year with a bang. For approximately 9,500 students who hadn't achieved any growth during their entire school experience, we finished the year with 68% of our students achieving one or more years growth in the area of mathematics, 64% of those children receiving or achieving one year's growth in the area of reading, more than 50% of them achieved more than 2 years growth. Excellent Schools Detroit, which is an outside evaluator, evaluated all of the schools in Detroit, over 124 schools in Detroit, including Detroit Public Schools, the Education Achievement Authority of Michigan, and Archdiocese Schools and Charter Schools. Of the 124 schools, our schools were managed to rank in terms of student growth in the top 20, with six of those schools ranking in the top six.
Mm-hmm. Great. Kudos to that. That deserves applause. And Alex, your definition of personalized learning and what you're up to these days.
So my journey with personalized learning started 3 years ago. I worked on a paper with Michael Horn called The Rise of K-12 Blended Learning. But more importantly, my twin boys were starting kindergarten at the time. And when I got to kindergarten with these children who are 5 years old, what we found, I started hearing things like, I'm not good at school, or I'm bored, or, and I'm like, this is crazy, these children are 5 years old. And so as I do, because I'm kind of a geeky educator, I started assessing the children in our school. Some of the tools I used were made by folks in this room. And what I found out is among five-year-olds, there was a six-year grade level spread among these children. Sometimes there's a five-year grade level spread within the same child. And there is no way we were doing everything we could possibly be doing for our school. So there was one neighbor I had who was particularly frustrated, and I turned him on to Dreambox, and he came back and he's like, I had an epiphany. I just want my child to get the instruction and support they need when they need it. And I'm like, that shouldn't be an epiphany. But he says, but it is, because my child's never had that. So I've always kept that with me as my definition of personalized learning. At the Growth Fund, we support the high-performing charter school networks who are trying to reinvent their schools, and it's a blast. We work with some great entrepreneurs.
So I'd like to talk about managing change. Managing change doesn't happen by itself. It takes leadership. And of course, it takes policies and planning, procedures, procurement, but most importantly, people. And so much of systems change is about people and generating buy-in from your people. John, how were you able to do that when you were starting personalized learning at the EAA?
Well, personalized learning and teaching children from the student-centered approach is so vastly different than anything that we've done in the past. And so we really had to make sure that the buy-in was there, the commitment from teachers and administrators were there. And so, to be honest, what we did was to try to, during the interview process, when we're jump-starting the Education Achievement Authority, is to upfront make sure that we were recruiting those individuals with the mindset and who would view the Education Achievement Authority as a unique opportunity to be creative and innovative and to move our schools from the traditional paradigm, one that I believe that we should have moved from as a country eons ago, and to take this as an, and use it as an opportunity to create change. Once you, I guess, get people in place, one of the things as a leader that you have to do is you have to be willing to accept the fact that if you're talking about giving them autonomy and flexibility, you have to pull back and trust them to do the job that they've been hired to do. Now, that's a little nerve-wracking at times because we have some really creative and innovative teachers who are really, who's really taken our approach to the next level.
Alex, a related question.
Sorry, can I just jump in on that? So I think the change management's really interesting when it comes to personalized learning. I used to work for a school system, and it'd be like, we're going to roll something out, and you're all going to do it. And on the other hand, you know, they're thinking, I'm going to be here a lot longer than you, and I'm just going to wait it out. We're going to duck and cover. And there's just terrible push and pull. And what I found with personalized learning is, first of all, sometimes the schools will pull it in themselves. If you're doing awesome things, like, when's the last time that happened in a school system? Or sometimes the kids and the families will pull it in. So I've seen a lot of innovation among school systems here. If you look at Los Altos, they've got an iLearn program where they train these blended learning champions that are teachers that go into schools and are really the leaders. Or you know, Riverside Unified that, you know, really focuses on their early adopters. And it's just fun to think about how can you do really cool stuff by investing in your most innovative educators, because it's so contrary about how we often think about making change happen.
So as you look to invest in high-potential charter management organizations, so much of what you're doing is betting on people.
Yeah.
And people that are going to go out and envision our next generation school models. So what is the DNA, what are you looking for in those leaders?
Yeah.
So you look for people that can do this change management work and lead with a bold vision.
So first of all, very clearly, we invest in people. We invest in leaders. It takes a special type of entrepreneur who can question everything they think they know about school. It takes a special type of entrepreneur who can really focus in on the student experience. So we were evaluating this piece of online software, and everyone is really grumpy about it. And, you know, what's the data going to teachers? And what's the data going to administrators? And finally, this teacher raised her hand, and she said, what about the data going to students? Which was awesome, by the way. And I was just like, yes, yes. It's about what is the data going to students and what is their experience. So we see our best innovators able to focus on student experience in a very real way. I would say I'll stop there.
John, the EAA is almost a year and a half into implementing your personalized learning model in your 15 schools. Let's rewind a bit. If you could go back a year, what would you do differently?
I think if we could turn back the hands on the clock and go back a year, I think some of the things that we would do differently, well, some of the things I know we would do differently is we would make sure that state funding for an initiative like this is in place at the very, very outset. We experienced a few challenges over the course of last year as a result of those funding or revenue resources not being in place, which made the job somewhat difficult. Another thing we would do is we would make sure that we would spread the professional development opportunities for teachers and staff across the entire year, rather than having so much of it uploaded on the front end. Teaching in a student-centered approach, where children are working at their own pace and they're moving through various instructional levels, because we've eliminated grade levels. In the Education Achievement Authority, there is no such thing as kindergarten, first grade, second grade, third grade. We've totally eliminated that model and moved away from that. And so it takes some time for teachers, administrators, to get their hands or their arms around this concept. And so to make sure that things are going well, I would certainly encourage anyone who might have some thought of moving to a student-centered approach is to make sure that the professional development opportunities for staff is spreaded over the entire year, rather than trying to do it all at once, because it's just too much for individuals to grasp at one time.
Do you guys think it's the right time to be scaling personalized learning in traditional districts, or are we still in R&D phase right now?
I think there's a big rush to declare success or victory, and I think it's a mistake. If I walked out to Disneyland right now and I grabbed a three-year-old and I look at him and say, you know what, I don't think you're gonna work out. Like, you'd look at me like I was crazy. But that's what we're doing. Blended learning's 3 years old. MOOCs, Coursera just turned two yesterday. I mean, it is really, really early. And there's some things that we figured out that we are able to scale. Spire scaling its model pretty consistently across its network. We've got a few other folks, but some of this stuff's really, really difficult. We haven't figured it out yet. If you think about diving, you know, this dive has a really high degree of difficulty, and you're trying to impress the Russian judge. But you know, the truth is, we're still trying to figure out how this stuff works.
In the Education Achievement Authority, we are already at scale in terms of the implementation of the student-centered approach in all of our schools. We move very, very quickly with a sense of urgency. When you consider the fact that we acquired 15 of Detroit public schools, and when those schools were acquired, less than 18% of the children were proficient in the area of reading. Less than 2% of them were proficient in the area of math. Less than 7% were proficient in the area of social studies, and I think 0% of those children were proficient in the area of science. And then prior to us coming to Michigan to jumpstart the Education Achievement Authority, the emergency manager for Detroit Public Schools reported that of the 67,000 students in the city of Detroit, they didn't have a single student to graduate from its high schools, college, and career ready. Not a single student. And so when you talk about the sense of urgency, and when you talk about the possibility of losing another generation of young people, not to ratchet this up and not to move as quickly as we can possibly move to make sure that we are meeting students where they are in order for them to master those skills that they need to finish next generation ready. I think not to do that would be absolutely criminal. And very quickly, I often tell the story. To make my point, I often tell the story of, and I hope you guys, I think most of you can remember Wally and Beaver Cleaver and their friend who lived across the street, Eddie Haskell. If we were somehow able to resurrect those three young men and have them to walk the corridors of our schools and to sit into our classrooms, the only thing that Wally and Beaver would find somewhat remotely odd is the strange transistor radios that today's young people are walking around with, or they might find a little odd the ethnicity of the children in the buildings. But as soon as they go into the classroom and sit down and they start, and the teachers start to teach, they're going to feel a lot more at home than our current 21st century digital native young people who exit their mother's womb with a laptop in one hand and an iPod in the other. We have to do this work, and we have to do it now.
Alex, I want to go back to your comment on, you know, blended learning, personalized learning, really being 3 years in right now. So how do we measure success and failure in the district pilot school? Or should we be, I mean, given the startup nature of it, measuring that so soon, given that they're inherently designed in a more innovative fashion or a more radical design to it?
Yeah, I mean, we're not the first industry to try a new idea. And you try something, and you keep doubling down on what's working well, and you stop what's not working well. And you keep going until you decide whether it's worth turning over the next card. And we need to take more of that mentality here, because asking for a five-year Mathematica study on a school that's only been around for 2 years makes absolutely no sense. But I hear that all the time. So we need to collect as much evidence as we possibly can, and we need to collect non-traditional evidence as well. I get really frustrated when people criticize assessment, because we should be coming up with new assessments if we're actually that angry about it. But you actually don't see that much work for brand new types of assessments in our schools. And I think there's a big opportunity to collect data ways that we've never done before. I'm really excited about the stuff Bright Bytes is doing out of San Francisco to think about how different stakeholders in the school system are thinking about technology. And I think we're going to have more partners like that, or what Khan's doing with dashboards for teachers. And I think there's going to be a lot of opportunity to look at lots of different things.
Yep. So Alex, every day we're reading about another school system going one-to-one and adopting what seems to be hardware as a strategy, sort of defined as, let's buy the device now, we'll figure out what we're going to do with it later. For the school system leaders in this room that are thinking about going one-to-one, what would you say to them?
So if the whole strategy is going one-to-one, that's not going to transform your school system. What you're really saying is, I'm going to go to Best Buy, I'm going to buy a bunch of stuff, and everything's going to be different. That's not how change happens. So the recommendation that we give to folks is, think about what's the student experience that you're trying to create. What do you want? Do you want kids doing self-directed learning? Are you trying to really optimize intervention? Like, what is it that you're trying to accomplish from a teaching and learning standpoint? And frankly, you're going to find that a lot of that stuff's possible even without the fancy whiz-bang stuff. So I think there's a teacher in the room, Shane Donovan, who's a teacher at E.L. Haynes. He moved to a completely competency-based environment with some Chromebooks, some free software, and he spent $160 on Mastery Connect. And a ton of elbow grease. This is hard work, don't get me wrong. But he started with a student experience, and now he's turned over that card and says, okay, where do I want to invest? What do I want to get right next? And that's absolutely the right place to start. We see so many school systems who have 20,000 iPads, and all of a sudden someone says, uh-oh, what app should we put on it? And it's a problem.
Yep.
A one-to-one device, I guess, would be good. That would be nice to have, but it's not absolutely positively mandatory that you have them to, at a ratio of one-to-one, mm-hmm. to totally and successfully implement a student-centered blended learning model for young people. Many members of my team and I first started implementing the student-centered model in Kansas City, Missouri School District, where we didn't have that. So it's doable without that.
Yep. So a recent survey of district leaders asked the following question. If a group of charter schools shows significant positive results with the personalized learning model, would that motivate your district to implement a similar model? And out of 252 district respondents, 48% said yes. And 52% said no, with the latter saying that the district environment is too different from the charter environment. John, when you hear this, what do you think?
In some cases, the environment is a little different, particularly for traditional school districts. And I think district leaders worry about not having the flexibility and the autonomy to implement the way they feel that the model should be implemented because of regulations and at the federal level, at the state level, and because of policy. But I can assure you that this model can be implemented in a traditional school district, although the traditional versus the charter school districts might be a little different just in terms of the flexibility that they have, but it can be done. And the other thing that I might add is, if this is an initiative that we really believe in, then we have to look beyond the obstacles of implementing the model, particularly when you consider the fact that we are maintaining a system of public schooling in this country that's as old as the country itself. We have to cease and desist from thinking about the level of difficulty or the level of ease if we really believe in the rights of children to have a high quality educational experience that will enable them to perhaps many of them sit in this room one day. So we can't do it because of or we can't do it thinking about the level of difficulty or the level of ease. We have to do this work because we think it's right.
Alex, when it comes to education innovation, the simpler your thing is, the easier it is it's going to be to scale, right? Yeah. Makes sense. But given the state of our K-12 education system, there's been a lot of talk about disruptive innovation. Mm-hmm. What should district leaders be focused on? Should they be focused on more incremental changes that can help move the needle, or should they be focused on things that are disruptive?
So I think you just need to have a vision for what you're going to do in the short term and what you're going to do in the long term. I'm really bullish on giving kids more control of their learning. I'm really bullish on competency-based environments. Really, really difficult to do. You need to pilot it in really small, tight environments till you kind of get it stable and get it right. You can grow it from there. It's a long-term investment. Some stuff you can get up and running now in 3 months. And so there's these various levels of difficulty. I actually don't think districts are competing with charters or charters with districts. I actually think we're competing with what's going on outside of school right now. And I kind of feel like the water seeping in. Like before we could just lock the doors and tune out the rest of the world, but now like the water's seeping in and we're starting to stand on the chair so we don't get our feet wet. And you know, pretty soon it's gonna be so ridiculous of all the amazing things that's going on outside the walls of the classroom that like you just can't ignore it anymore. One of the biggest levers for change we've found have been the young teachers that have been coming into the system. For them, personalization is not a thing, it's just life. And you know, we've found that they're just great agents for change because of course we do this for our children. And we're seeing the same thing with families. You know, of course I'd want this for my children. Why wouldn't I want to let my child pass out of third grade math so they can do more time on robotics? Like, why wouldn't you want that? So I think we actually have a lot to learn, not just from each other, mm-hmm. but actually from our families and our communities, because there's some exciting things going on outside of school right now.
And just a quick reminder, keep your questions coming on our Twitter feed. Hashtag iNACOL13. I already have a couple of them up here, so keep them coming. And we're going to switch gears a little bit. So over the next couple minutes, I'm going to throw up some interesting quotes, and I'd love to get your reactions to them. The first one is from Chester Finn. I'm convinced that key elements of online and blended learning cannot thrive under the constraints of today's system of education governance, finance, and choice. This technology has the potential to revolutionize the entire education delivery system, but the system has plenty of vested interests that will do all in their power to keep that from happening. Your thoughts?
I think to a large extent, there's some truth to what Flynn is saying. When you talk about the kind of radical change that comes with implementing a model, particularly in the way that we've implemented the model in the Education Achievement Authority, there are a lot of detractors out there that would rather not see it happen. So I'm in agreement with basically what he said.
But you still think that personalized learning can happen in traditional
schools? Oh, absolutely.
Schools.
Absolutely, without question.
Look, it's hard. This is hard work even without all the bureaucratic structures, but I think in this room you have some examples of some phenomenal leaders, and you look at the work that's going on in Reynoldsburg and Milpitas and Quakertown. I mean, just incredible, incredible things happening when you get your organization pointed in the same direction. You have a vision about where you're gonna go. So the reason I wake up with a smile every day is I actually just don't think you can stop this. Like, it's gonna happen. Like, either you're gonna do it or it's gonna be done to you. And it's kind of fun.
Awesome. Our next quote, this one's from Diane Ravitch. Indianapolis has okayed the opening of 19 new charter schools based on the concept of blended learning. The schools will lean heavily on technology to reduce the teaching staff and save money while promising higher test scores. Embedded in this approach is the belief that computers do a better job of teaching basic skills than live teachers. or that vast sums of money can be saved by dividing instruction between computers and teachers.
Diane. Diane. First of all, the use of technology in our classrooms has never been intended to replace the teacher. Teaching and learning is a social interaction. That's not going to ever change. But when you talk about differentiating instruction to a teacher, to 25 kids in a classroom, how dare we ask teachers who work hard each and every day to attempt to do something like that without a tool that's going to help him or her get that kind of work done. And so I think Diane's belief is somewhat misguided if she thinks for 1 minute that we're going to have classrooms where we sit children in front of computers like iRobot all day long and do nothing else. That's not how the system is designed to work.
Thanks. So Diane's had a change of tone around technology just like in the last month or so. She was very, very dismissive
Good.
About technology. And if you read the comment sections below, you'd read things like, I love Diane, but that's crazy. You can't talk about technology that way. So she's kind of changed her tone. But the lesson I take away from all this is how, as leaders, we talk about this opportunity matters a lot. If you're leading a school system, do not talk about technology. Talk about what you're trying to do for children. Talk about personalization.
Yes.
By the way, personalization doesn't have to mean technology. It could be your Montessori classroom. It could be a Socratic seminar. It could be that book that's, you know, challenging you into a new level of reading. And, you know, I think we have this belief that, you know, there's all these magical moments happening in traditional classrooms. You know, if you go in and look, I mean, kids are kind of in their zone of learning less than a quarter of a time, maybe less than 15% of the time. So what I'm trying to figure out is, like, what are those magic moments? Let's raise them up, and let's have the adults just focus on that their entire day. And, you know, let's create other structures and innovations for the rest of the day. So I think this is a massive opportunity, and, you know, I would encourage you as leaders to really be thoughtful about how you talk to your families and your communities and your teachers about this, because there's messages that just turn people off, and there's messages that, you know, give people a lot of hope and inspiration.
Our final quote's from Whitney Tilson. While online schools can be an excellent option for certain students, it's a very small number, typically those who have a high degree of self-motivation and strong parental commitment.
I'm a big believer that families should be able to choose the education option that's right for them. And yeah, the fact that we would disparage a kid who is self-motivated is crazy to me. Or, you know, we disparage families who get involved in their education is nuts to me. We should be, you know, doing everything we can for every, you know, for every family. I've got 7-year-old twin boys. There's nothing easy about raising these children. They've got a lot of advantages, but, you know, every day I worry. Like, I'm wondering if I'm giving them the right education. And for every child, we need to get to know them so well and their circumstances so well that we can deliver, you know, the best experience possible for them. You know, let the families choose rather than us sitting in a building somewhere without windows trying to tell them what's best for them.
Anything that we can do to expand alternative opportunities, alternative in the truest sense, alternative opportunities for young people to get a great education, I think we should be doing it. And I think at some point we're going to have to realize that when we talk about the educational experience, it doesn't necessarily have to take place in the confines of the traditional brick and mortar building. And so many children, even in Detroit, come to school each day. And for those who don't come because of a lot of obstacles sometimes that preclude them from coming. But if they had an alternative, which we've provided for them in many cases, they have a tendency to take advantage of it.
All right, we're going to pick up the pace now. I'm going to channel my inner Jim Cramer, and we're going to do a quick lightning round. I'm going to toss out a word, and John and Alex will have 10 seconds to throw out sort of their impulsive first thoughts. All right, here we go. Teach for America.
I'm pro-teacher and pro-America.
A good resource for American public schools.
MOOCs.
So I watched Learning Creative Learning from MIT on my big screen TV, and it was kind of like, I look forward to it, like Breaking Bad or something. So it's kind of fun to figure out new ways of learning right now.
10 seconds.
Another opportunities for young people and teachers to learn and grow.
Common Core State Standards.
Why is it controversial to have high expectations for our kids?
To a large extent, misunderstood. I think we can do a better job of explaining that the Common Core Standards is not a curriculum that's going to somehow do away with local control, but it's their standards.
Khan Academy.
Okay. We're a $600 billion industry. Why did it take a hedge fund manager to create Khan Academy? Seriously. Seriously. Like, we need to step it up a little bit. I'm just saying.
One of many great opportunities, one of many resources.
Parent advocacy.
Parents are not people to be controlled. They are people we should be appealing to with schools that they want for their own children, that we want for our own children.
I think we need to do a better job of bridging the gap between the home and the school. I think there's a lot more that we can be doing.
Course choice.
The secret to reinventing high schools. I don't know why school is monopoly and we have to produce 30 hours of programming. We need people laser focused in on particular things and stitching together great experiences for our kids.
One word, I agree. Well, that was two words.
For profits and education.
Red herring. Until you're ready to, until you get up in arms and protest their Scholastic Book Club, you know, when your kids get that little catalog and the teachers work for free on the behalf of a for-profit corporation, until you're outraged about that, like, save me the selective moral outrage.
In some cases, there's certainly a place for for-profit to partner with public schools in the area of charters that are for-profit. I think they should probably be scrutinized a lot closer to make sure that the money is actually getting to children.
Your favorite education website or blog?
Ooh. It's a good one.
Don't look at me.
There's none out there?
No, there's a ton. There's a ton. I'm enjoying...
He wants to say his own blog.
Come on. I'm enjoying the Montessori blogs right now. So Cassandra with Montessori for All and Joan Young and a few others. There's some really great plays. I think the intersection between, you know, the maker movement right now and the personalized learning movement is really, really exciting. And I read everything that has to do with that.
There's a ton of them out there. I would agree with that. And I don't have a particular favorite.
Mm-hmm. Coding.
All right, I'm throwing down the gauntlet. Coding is easier to learn outside of school than it is inside of school. And there's a whole bunch of stuff that's like that. So I think it's a great challenge for us as educators to figure out what to do with that.
I didn't hear the word.
Coding.
Oh, coding. I think it's very, very important. That's part of our move from having children be college and career ready to next generation ready. We believe it's a skill that all young people should be graduating from high school with the ability to do.
The thing you are most excited about in K-12 education?
The Education Achievement Authority of Michigan.
Oh. Softball.
The Education Achievement Authority of Michigan.
And the last one here, iNACOL.
I look forward to coming here every year. I love it. You do a great job, Susan. Thank you.
I didn't come last year. It's my first year here. I've thoroughly enjoyed it. A great partner, a great, great resource, and we really appreciate the opportunity not only to share what we're doing in the Education Achievement Authority, but certainly also the opportunity to learn from all of you. So thank you.
Great. All right, we're going to get to some of your questions. Thanks for sharing these through the Twitter feed. This one comes from Rose Fernandez. Opponents say online learning helps the few at the expense of many. How do we best defend until we are serving the many?
Man, man, I feel like we paint ourselves in these rhetorical corners and create these battles to fight over when really we should just be innovating in schools. Look, online learning is online. Anyone can access it. It's the great equalizer. You can go into a continent like Africa, and everyone has a mobile phone in Africa. And so, I'm actually really excited that you're not reliant on the school or some sort of gatekeeper to give you a great education. As a student or as a family, you can go out and just get it.
I just view it as another alternative for students. They're not all getting it on the same day, at the same rate, the same way. I don't think we should eliminate alternatives because it's working for this group and not working for this group over here.
This question comes from Penny Christensen. How do you think public K-12 teachers can be education entrepreneurs on their own, independent of school leadership?
The people are doing the most exciting stuff that I see. I mean, they're just mavericks. You just find a way right now. And I mean, you don't have to wait for policy to get changed. I mean, hopefully, Susan and her team get us competency-based learning in all 50 states, but I mean, you got to push ahead, and we're seeing our best entrepreneurs are doing that. I mean, they're crazy, they're great.
I would agree with that. Next year, we will be onboarding, I guess, the next group of schools in EAA as we begin to expand outstate Michigan, and this will be a school without the traditional administrators. It will be a school that's totally run and operated by teachers, so I support it.
This question comes from Adina Dershowitz. How do we balance personalized learning with a national culture of standardized testing?
I personally don't think we assess enough, to be honest. And what I'm excited about with a lot of the online learning is assessment just melts away. When you know everything your kid did for the last 20 minutes, that's probably more data than we collect in a year on most kids in face-to-face environments. And so we collect so much data that assessment melts away. I think that's the first thing. I think secondly, we need to be rethinking what we want, what it means to be an educated person. I mean, what if we brought maker education into our schools? Like, how do you think about that? I mean, maybe an assignment is we're going to teach you about social media, and to get an A, you have to get 1,000 followers on Twitter or something. I mean, we just need to really rethink what success looks like for kids. And I think we receive assurances from opponents of testing of, oh, we know everything about our kids. No, we don't. We need to really invest in as many different ways as possible to get to know our kids as well as we possibly can. And you do that by paying attention.
I think we need robust tools or assessment tools to make sure that we're doing a really good job of getting the data on kids that we need to have to make informed decisions about their learning. I think to have these assessments so that we can determine proficiency or lack thereof, as with the No Child Left Behind that occurs in various states, I think it's probably not a good idea. But to assess on a regularly, have a regularly scheduled assessment period to make sure that we're tracking students in terms of their growth, and I think that's what we should be doing. I think it's great.
I also think we need to not get so reductionist in what it means to be educated. So you're not going to learn to love reading Harry Potter because we spent 30 minutes on your long A sounds. I mean, maybe that's a piece of the story, but we've just gotten overly reductionist. And I think one of the exciting things is with online learning, there's so much data, you really have to look and see, wow, there's almost too much. What has the strongest correlation? And all of a sudden, things become really important that they weren't necessarily obvious that they were important before, and really strong indicators that your kids are doing what they're doing. So I think it's a really great opportunity to rethink how we do assessment. But like I said, we need to know more about our kids, not less.
So I can see that I'm getting the hook here. So I'm going to move on to invite your final thoughts. When it comes to personalized learning, what is left out of the debate? What should we be talking about that we're not currently talking about?
I think we need to really pay a lot more attention to the change of policy at the federal and at the state level. I think more often than not, teachers and administrators in the LEAs are willing to do this work, but become very, very frustrated, as do administrators in the central office, when they find themselves hamstrung by policies and regulatory superficial rules and regulations that don't allow them to move forward to do the work that we all know and believe that, that should be done. So I think that's the place where we should really pay a lot more attention to.
It's terrifying to admit we could have radically better schools. It's really terrifying to think how school can be different. But I think this is the great opportunity of our generation. We've learned so much about teaching and learning and assessment and socio-emotional and neuroscience. And I just think we have ways to mishmash this all together to create, you know, just things we've never thought about before. I think it's terrifying to, I mean, we've had 25 years of the reform movement, and we've had so many successes, so many victories, and at the same time, it's been 25 years. You know, there's a new generation of heroes in this room that's going to step up and redefine where we're going for the next generation, and that's exciting to me. And you know, this innovation's hard work. I see my friend John Dean over there. And I mean, these guys, I mean, at Summit are doing amazing, amazing stuff. But,
agreed.
You know, it's sexy to talk about in environments like this. It's like, you know, a naughty show on HBO or Showtime. It's edgy and hip and sexy. But, you know, innovating's a lot like C-SPAN. Yeah, nothing happens for long periods of time. You gotta walk away to the fridge. You know, you can't tell you're annoyed. You're annoyed at the people on TV. And so, I mean, this is just hard work. So, I mean, I think we just have to hold in our heads the wonderful opportunity that lays before us, that lays before us for our children, and temper that with, you know, this is really hard stuff. And like I said, I mean, there's heroes in this room who are gonna lead us forward.
Well, that's a wrap. Thank you for your participation, and much thanks to Dr. Covington, Alex Hernandez.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.